area which is like a very prominent area of Delhi since ancient times. If ever there is a film made on the northern Indian history, this area would be the trailer of that. So like you will find something of each era at this place. As per the known history, what we are going to discuss and what we are going to take as reference is the well-documented part that started like around 1,000 years ago. So this area marks, the prominence of this area is that the medieval period of Indian history starts here. I'm going to give you some information about the past beliefs as well, but there are no like evidences, solid evidences for that, but they have been a part of the folklore and partly could be true, or like you never know, but they hint towards something. For example, the oldest mention comes that this place was originally called Yoginipura. If you know the story of Mahabharata, at the time of the birth of Krishna, there was one girl who takes birth, like, because the evil king Kans is after Krishna's life. He wants to kill that baby before he's born. So the nature organizes like the thing so that like one girl appears in that jail chamber where Krishna was to be born, and he was confused what to do now, because he was expecting a baby boy so that he can kill. So that girl like is eventually the mother, the goddess of power, energy, Shakti, and she flies away from his hands and establishes at one place, which as per the scriptures is this place. And behind the Qutub Complex you have the ancient Yogini temple over there. The ancient structure no more exists, but it is documented so, and even like Mughal emperors have, Aurangzeb I guess, or one of the emperors got repair work done at that place. So it was already an ancient temple that time. So that is one of the ancient mentions. After that, some, again, like, when I say ancient, it is like things like which go back to BC, okay, before Christ now. In that era, there is another mention of a scholar known as Varah Mihir, who was asked to set up an observatory here. And the place was known as Mihravali because of his name. And there are mentions of a pillar being erected that time, which had like the dimensions of which are similar to the original dimensions of Qutub, which was like before adding the top floor, that is like 3 meters on the top and 14 on the base. But yeah, it's not in the current form. It could be, have been a simpler pillar which was built upon later on, but these are again like folklores, so no proofs, no evidences, so did not get documented. Then we come to the medieval actually documented part, which starts during the times of the Tomars. So rest of the story like we'll discuss as we progress. I would just like to show you a trailer of this walk first, so that we have a good idea of what we are going to traverse across. Aman, can you help me hold this map? Hi everyone. We've just started. This is still the trailer. So this is all like what we're going to discuss today, but of past knowledge. Do we understand a mix of Hindi and English, everyone? So we are going to discuss this not essentially in the chronology, but I'll tell you the chronology here. The first structure to have come up, not essentially first, but first as per the known history, documented history, is the mosque, the first Jama Masjid or the congregation mosque, which appeared in northern India after the rulers, like after Islamic rule started. The first mosque was established in 600 AD in Kerala. So that has a architecture also of the local land. It's not like, they didn't have a dome and all initially. And that was set up by a traveler. This time, the first time a sultan has established, Qutubuddin Aibak takes power, control of this land and establishes this small structure inside. This is called Quwwat-ul-Islam Mosque right now. The original name was simple Jama Masjid. Then we have, after Qutubuddin Aibak, Iltutmish, his successor, who Qutubuddin Aibak also like started the work on Qutub Minar and built the first story. So we had this complex and the first story. Then his successor comes in, he completes the minar till here, till the fourth story, and expands the mosque to take the Qutub also inside within the premises. After that, there is a political instability around for 100 years or so. We have stories of Sultan Razia and other like smaller kings taking control, but nobody was as strong till the times of Alauddin Khalji, who was like 100 years after this. For him already it was a heritage site, it was a 100 year old building, and he was quite ambitious. He wanted to make a minaret double the size of Qutub Minar, so he started work on this and also expanded the whole complex like to include everything inside. So that was during the time of Khaljis. It was kind of a fortress, and he had made ornamented gateways to it. One of the gates still exists, which is this one, and it later like was called as Alai Darwaza because it was from Alauddin Khalji's time. All of this is documented actually inside the Qutub. As you go around the stairs, they are like carvings and inscriptions there, which mention that this ruler did this and this ruler. Then we have, again, there are smaller structures that came up. This is like Imam, Zamin's tomb and all. We go there, and this also came at the time of Lodis. Then the era of Mughals comes, like it was again after the area started in 1000, like 1060 or so, this area, as per the known history. Mughals were here in 1500s something. So for them, again, it was a heritage site existing. What they did was, they didn't build upon this structure, but it must have been because of the mosque and the historical buildings. These must have been a very active place for visitors and tourists. So they actually established a serai in this area where we are standing right now. It was a serai is an inn for travelers, and they have like they can stay there overnight, and there are smaller bazaars for them, and like we have spas and other like pleasure activities. Those were like included in a serai, and they're given like food, and there is space for tethering animals. So this is that serai which came up in the Mughal period. We are standing in that area. If you look at the gateway from where we came from, that looks like a much modern structure as compared to the Lodi Garden buildings or the Tughluq buildings. Seeing the arches, and there is a similar gate this side. So if you look at the map, this is a conjectural reconstruction, like one of the Sanderson, I guess, the ASI in charge that time, had imagined like what could it have been and made this map. So where is the serai? See, this is the gate. This is where we entered from. Can everyone see, or should I bring it nearer? And this is the other gate. That one where we go. So let's take a quick round of this serai. It has interesting structures, but if we there could be a separate walk for this serai itself, but we are not going to do that right now because we'll miss on the other parts. But I would encourage all of us to just take a stroll. There is a beautiful Mughal garden there which not many people know, and this is a very beautiful post Shah Jahan era mosque. It's very simple on the ground floor, but the domes that you see are like very much like the buildings that were made after Shah Jahan era. So let's take a walk there. This is still an active mosque. Thank you. lot more to discover. So this was when the ASI started, mid of 19th century or so. This mosque was in a dilapidated condition. It was in like ruins. One of the British officers actually identified this as a post-Mughal era building and reconstructed it. And now it is an active mosque. If you come here early morning, you can actually like go inside and have a look. It's a very like, even if you just sit there, it's a calm place to be at. Full of greenery and you see squirrels and parrots all around. So let's just have a look at it and enter the grand Mughal Garden. As we walk, let's also try and imagine that the travelers of like 1500, 16th century actually walked in this garden like how we are walking and enjoying the weather and the greenery here. This is a charbagh concept. You see the four squares. So as per the Islamic belief, this is the map or the design of heaven actually. So that's why you see a lot of rulers have made their final resting places or even leisure lawns in the form of a charbagh, which is considered to be pure and pious, and the center is supposed to be the house of salvation. So that's why you will see around Humayun's tomb there is a charbagh, around Safdarjung's tomb there is a charbagh. So on the same grounds this was made in that design. There is not much explanation about like as per ASI records what this place was, but if you look around, you'll see like these were the chambers behind you. These were small chambers, and it is still apparent that there was like walls going up and which had fallen down, only the base still remains. If you see this side, you still have plastered work, and those are like showcases, or if you see those cavities in the walls for keeping lamps and other pieces and all. All this structure also was plastered. What we are seeing is rubble, big stones and all. This is how construction used to happen in that era. Made of like the local stone is very quartz. It was breaks of hill and bring the stones here and finish. And then plaster it with a main material. The plaster has fallen off. In those parts you can still see the plaster. Those are like dressed stones above rubble. That is how Qutub Minar also have been built. Inside it is rubble. On the surface you have rest tiles. When you go to Alai Minar, you get to see the inside view of Qutub. It is actually a replica. Could not get completed, but we get to see how Qutub was designed. These structures, these canopies above this and on that side, the corner, sitting behind the trees, but you have a canopy like this. When you walk inside, you can get a better view of the small tombs. They look very much like Mughal era forts, watchtowers. So let's soak in for look out for like noticeable things around, and then we'll walk out. they had like the Turks came brought this technology of plastering, which was bricks, powdered bricks. You grind the bricks and you add limestone, chuna, and like if you right now also see conserved monuments, they are like pinkish in color. That gives the color. So that has, I'm not an expert at it, but it has a tendency to absorb water when it rains and then it releases it back. So that's what makes it strong. Whereas cement traps it, so that makes it weak, but cheap to construct, like to build with cement. So this like gives the strength, and this all is like, if you go to the Faridabad area, you still have some hillocks, and the tail of Aravali is here in Delhi. So this comes from Delhi quartz, comes from those hills. So that's why we still, it is rock solid. It the plaster fuses with the stone and becomes as good as stone. Let's go. So we'll now be going to that Alai Minar, Alauddin Khalji's incomplete minaret. But we stopped here to just look around, and I showed you a gateway, one of the gateways discussed, staircase, bacha hua. So if you walk down there, is a cavity between, like that's actually a staircase. If you go there, you'll see like double stairs going right in front of the Alai Minar. And when you observe, like we'll walk through these pillars, you'll actually see there is a difference in the way these have been constructed or carved out. From the Qutub, like as per the map, we get a reference that in front of Qutub Minar, like it was complex. So these pillars look different.
Was available.
These pillars were a part of Alauddin Khalji's extension. These are like 100 years later with more modern technology. So these are more seasoned, more plain, and like they are better designed. And inside, it is like the original pillars you will see, which were made of like temple pillars. So they still have temple carvings. So that's a very secular place. It's a mosque with temple design. So like it's a very photogenic structure. You see that a lot of photographers have been taken. So let's first go to the Alai Minar. That is a living example of man proposes, God disposes. And it is also believed that the original Mehroli Badarpur road passed through this way actually, and went to the Mehroli area inside. Behind this, it is the road that goes to the bus terminal. You will see buses going from there. So it was later changed while the British redesigned the area, because they wanted to conserve this. You imagine traffic going from a heritage site. So that's the purpose. Otherwise the original road was here. Such places give us a very good opportunity of course, the stats, the high diameter and all this. I've got this in this file, a little bit in my head. You have everything in Wikipedia. But what is not on Wikipedia is the experience of imagining that Alauddin Khalji would have walked through this walkway and monitored the construction of this minar and would have imagined that it would have been, and I'm like so great and all. And so many laborers actually working here, cutting the stone. The history about this minaret is just that we know that Khalji was a very ambitious king and very powerful one also. He was able to like bring order to the place by force or by whatever means. Like we know Mohammed bin Tughluq as like one of the not great, but somebody who expanded the empire. So before him, it was like his first version was Alauddin Khalji, who actually used a lot of force and took control in his hands. The other side of his ambition was construction, and he was very fond of symmetry. So like his structures need to have like, they are like rectangular or they have symmetrical gateways. So it was only due to those hints that the British conservationist like who made this map, what I showed, he was able to imagine that Alai Darwaza was not the only Darwaza. There were like six more surrounding the complex. There's not much history about this because this is incomplete. We know about the person who got it built, but this gives us a good idea of how the Qutub was built actually. So when we go to the other side, there is a bigger window. So we'll see an inner solid core of stone, and outside these structure have been made. Khalji was probably more inclusive king, so his idea was not to have a staircase inside but a ramp which would go so that everyone can climb up.
More inclusive.
Yeah. So that could not get completed. But yeah, this, the material that you see is all rubble from the local hills, and the plan was to like have dressed stone on it, like Qutub has, maybe of sandstone or something. For people who have studied architecture, you would know that still we have, wherever you have a colonnaded structure, we make designs on the columns. And if you make vertical grooves, one is like plain columns like if you have in CP. If you made decorated columns like people have usually in their gardens, they have vertical cuts, grooves. So vertical grooves are known as fluting. Okay. There is a different name for horizontal design, but vertical design is called fluting. Fluting can be like, if you look at the Qutub, the just see at the ground level, there are round structure and then there are triangular structures as well. So the round one is round fluting and the angled one is angular fluting. So this gives a good view when you look at it from the bottom or from the top. Any tall building, it gives an illusion of greater height. If you have a plain structure, it won't look as high as the one which has grooves. So this again had fluting in that. You can see this zigzag structure.
From the base or from the top?
Anywhere. From the base only. From the top it is difficult to do in that. Still we need like drones and all. So let's go to the that side, less sunny side. And we'll have a bigger window there. Here and have a look at the core inside. It gives you a good idea. And
there is no way to go inside.
There is a way. But ye thoda sa dhaga laga hua aapko rokne.
Nahi, but still I didn't find any way.
There is no way to come out. Andar seedhiyan nahi bani hui. And this is the staircase. If you walk up there, you will actually see a staircase, and you can imagine another Alai Darwaza here, which has fallen down. So Alauddin Khalji was around 100 years after the Sultanate period started. Khalji started work on this in 1297. And it was like, I guess, 1316 he died, and the work on this stopped that time. And this has also been mentioned in, you must have heard of Amir Khusro. The great scholar, musician, poet, and he was even a warrior before at Balbun's time, Qiyasuddin Balbun's time. So he has documented in Tarikh-e-Alai, that is the history of the Alauddin Khalji's time, about the grand expansion on the Quwwat-ul-Islam Mosque. That time it was called, simply called Jama Masjid, not Quwwat-ul-Islam Mosque. So he mentions about the Minar and the screens. The screen is like towards Mecca, it is best here, we make mihrab. So Qutubuddin Aibak, Iltutmish, everyone made these huge structures. Like you can see that pillar there, which is now broken. In front of Qutub Minar still is like higher. And so Khalji wanted to make a double, like double than that. So we'll walk up there and we'll see the ruins of the screen. So Amir Khusro mentions about the grand work done in the time of Alauddin Khalji and also the art done on the screens. So let's go from that side and we'll have a look at the ruins and then go to Iltutmish. No, this one.
Do you see those structures there?
The screens that we call, when we go inside we will see bigger screens. These were like the mihrab, kind of mihrab for the Quwwat-ul-Islam Mosque, facing towards west, towards where we have to face and pray. So maintaining the proportion of this minar.
So those are the screens for that mosque.
Khalji wanted to make something double. So he started work on double sized screens. So what you see here is what remains of the Alauddin Khalji screens of that mosque. He made like higher and wider, broader screens for that. When we go there, you will have a better idea of what this looked like. But still this gives you some idea about what I was telling, that inside you have rubble, on the surface you have dressed stone, which is plain, and on this you do your carving or tile work or whatever work you want to do. And then like later in the Mughal period, when this was a serai, smaller graves and other wells, there is a well, it's called a well down there, we missed that. So it's not like open, but yeah, it is historical, so it is like something charming. These all came up like when people started actually maybe staying here in the sarais, and there is a very prominent Sufi saint in this area. Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki. In fact, behind the Mehrauli bus terminal, there is one of the graves, which is like after Ibn-e Sharif, he is the most prominent saint who came here like during the rule of Iltutmish. After when the work on Qutub Minar started, he came to Delhi. And there is another belief that if you are buried near a pure soul, it gives you also salvation. So usually royal people and rich people try to have their tombs or simple graves near a Sufi saint's dargah. That is the reason that you have Lodi Garden there, because Nizamuddin Aulia shrine is there. Similarly out here also, and in Mehrauli Archaeological Park nearby, you have several tombs and graves scattered all around. Most of these were rich people who could afford some piece of land near a Sufi. So we'll just slowly walk across that area and go to that tomb. You see a lot of, this is a very small mosque for the travelers. We still have inscription inside, a Mughal era mosque. Let's walk there. And you also see the remains of the temples inside. If you've been to Morena or Gwalior and seen the temples there, the work on these, the pieces that you're going to see looks very similar to those the temples based on Tantra that we have out there. That is Mehrab. I don't know how to read that, but probably it reads that who erected it and who sponsored it. The idea of a mosque is not to house everyone inside. You just give the direction, tell the direction, and you have some verses written and people gather outside and pray. Jama is actually a collection. So Jama Masjid is a congregation, collection of people. You tell them the direction and because everyone has come there together, there is a different aura of the place and you worship. these all are in line with those screens, all these structures that you see. If you want, I can refer to that map again, it will give you a better idea. So these are the structures that we are talking about. Which are like wider and higher than the original screen that you see. And they actually had carvings on it with arabesque and calligraphy done. We'll see some remains of the calligraphy on those screens. So you can imagine that the calligraphy on these would have been even better because it was like 100 years after that with more modern technology and trained artisans. Ruins pade hue hain which did not find a place inside the complex, so they've left it here. This is a common feature in a lot of ASI monuments. Even in temples you'll see that things that they excavated it out but could not find a place in the design, so they keep it in the backyard. Peculiarly I've seen this in the tantric temples of Mithavali and Padavali in Gwalior and Morena. So you'll see actually idols carved out of this. Not there, like the structures were there, pani nahi tha, so like if aaya tha nahi abhi. So these were the pillar bases of when the place had Hindu and Jain temples. So these are pillar bases from that time. And the Sultanate era culture is referred to as a man of like high morals and pretty spiritual and religious. So these are like 20 stairs that actually lead us to his actual grave. When Gordon Sanderson, the ASI in charge, was given the task to renovate this, so when they went downstairs, they found rubble inside. Things had broken and all, and they were not sure that if we remove the rubble, maybe the structure comes down. So they left it the way it was, and they covered this so that nobody can go inside. The cenotaph and the tomb is here, so let's walk in. Thank you. area saw a major change with Mohammad of Ghor finally being able to defeat Prithviraj Chauhan after a couple of attempts. And he establishes, like, there is a thing called iconoclasm, which means that you bring down the prevalent icons, religions, or if you see stories of independence, freedom struggle, you see like revolutionaries going up a British building and bringing their flag down and questioning them. So that is, those acts are iconoclasm. You bring down icons and you set up your own icons there as a show of power. So similarly, Mohammad Ghori, like first thing he did was setting up a Jama Masjid in this land. We'll talk about that masjid later on. And the Qutub Minar as per the recorded history. So that went on, and Iltutmish was one of his generals that time, and Iltutmish also helped him a lot during these times. So in 1211, when Iltutmish took over the throne, he started like bringing order to the place and also expanding the empire. Like, he actually took control of the Ranthambore area and Gwalior area. So these were like his political achievements. Other than this, he's considered to be as a role model for a lot of people, like of high moral values, and something like Akbar that we know of, and even more spiritual than Akbar, because there are stories of his childhood where Sufi saints had a great impact on Iltutmish, and he respected them a lot. And it is believed that he dedicated the minaret to Qutub Sahib, and hence it is called, it is related to Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki, and it used to be known as Qutub Sahib Ki Laat, which is like the walking stick, as if like it is dedicated to him. So this is his grave. He ruled till 1236, 1237 I guess. So, but the grave, the tomb actually dates back to 1 year prior. So there is confusion, like some people believe that he got it constructed himself, which is a very normal thing in that time. The emperors used to like reserve a space for their final resting place. Some believe that it was built by Sultan Razia, that's the first woman monarch of this land. She was one of his wards, like the daughter he had, and the sons were not, it is believed so that they were not like up to the mark,
competent enough
to be a ruler. And he himself wanted Razia to rule the land, but he had a cabinet of ministers, like the close ones. They were all men, and they were not ready to accept the woman as the leader. So like she could not rule for long. It was only for 4 years that she ruled. So it could have been that it was built during that time, but the greater probability is that he got it built himself, because this has been done like with a lot of passion, and a lot of time must have been like devoted to this, which is not possible in the times of Razia, because she had to like face a lot of unrest. If you look at architecturally and art-wise, this is again built with rubble, but sandstone and carvings on the surface. And again, it is believed that it had a tomb, because for the first time in the history of this subcontinent, a new technology was used, which is called squinch arches. So if you notice, like this is a square structure, but the dome above is circular, or would have been circular. This is octagonal or like some polygon right now, but achieving a circular base. So that time this was done with the help of squinch arches. So these corners that you see, these structures are known as squinch arches, which enable us to like, it brings another edge to the square. Okay. Similarly, this side. So it is able to support now an octagonal structure. And then you have these are known as corbels, these small pillar looking structures, which further jut out
and give another way to another platform above. Do you see the division line? From the square you get, first you get one base, then you get another smaller base. Jo corbel ke upar ek chota sa base aur. So you are dividing the polygon into smaller edges further and achieving a circular base finally. So this was for the first time used here, these twin arches. Or you can say that this is the like oldest building surviving that we know that has twin arches and corbels. Qutub again has a lot of twin arches outwards. So when we go there, we'll see the arches there. So they invested so much in this, the latest technology that time. So there must have been a tomb above. As a freeway nahi karaya hua shayad. But there is another belief that this never had a tomb, because some people believe in open graves, like Qutub Sahib himself, who originally the grave did not have a tomb. And also, some architects say that if there was a dome here, due to the weight, the structure is so that it would have fallen apart. So there was no dome that they say, but as per the recorded history, this had a dome and the twin arches were made specifically to support a dome above. And the verses, the calligraphy that you see written around here, is believed, I guess it is Quranic verses, right? Okay. So these are Quranic verses which are written on tiles and then like laid on the main construction. This was the mihrab that is like faced here and there. If you see like all the screens are on this side, the west. This again is the mihrab. So Mohammad of Ghor, what you said more about Iltutmish is not just known as a ruler. He's seen as a very like guy of high moral characters and who was very much into spirituality. So Aziz can tell you more about that, the Sufi side of Altamash. Still, like, just one trivia I would like to tell, that parents like name their children Altamash with like great fondness. Still.
Achha admi. Those log nahi aate aise log. अच्छा था तो हुआ ये एक बार कि बहुत पुरानी बात है तकरीबन जबकि जब पृथ्वीराज चौहान दिल्ली में था और तब तक हिंदुस्तान आया मोहम्मद वाली हिंदुस्तान नहीं आया तो ये वो ज़माना था जब ग़ुलामों को बहुत ज़्यादा तवज्जो दी जाती थी मतलब उनको बाकायदा ट्रेनिंग दी जाती थी कि वो आपकी दरबार शाही में जो है वो आपकी खिदमत करें और अक्सर ऐसा होता था कि जो बहुत काबिल ग़ुलाम होता था उससे सुल्तान अपनी बेटी की शादी करा लेते थे तो एक बार एक कबीले से सेंट्रल एशिया में एक छोटा सा बच्चा जो है जो ग़ुलाम लोग खरीदते वो मतलब फरोख्त करते थे वो छोटा सा बच्चा उस कबीले से चुरा कर ले और उसको ले जाकर जो है उन्होंने कहीं पे भेज दिया अब वो बच्चा जो है अब ग़ुलाम था बहुत देखने में खूबसूरत अब उसको जो है उसके आका ने कुछ पैसे दिए और कहा कि भैया जाओ और बाज़ार से जो है फल ले आओ वो लड़का गया बाज़ार और जब वो पहुंचा वहाँ पे तो उसे पता चला कि जो पैसे उसके आका ने दिए थे वो चोरी हो गए अब वो रोने लगा वहाँ पर और जब वो रोने लगा तो इतने में जो है एक दरवेश एक फ़कीर वहाँ पर जो है गम जाहिर हुए और उन्होंने उससे रोने का जो है वो वजह पूछी तो उसने कहा भैया मेरे आका ने मुझे इतने पैसे दिए थे फल लाने के लिए वो तो चोरी हो गए अब मैं वापस कैसे जाऊँ तो उसने कहा कि अगर वो तुम्हें पैसे मिल जाए तो तुम चुप हो जाओगे मैं चुप हो जाऊँगा उन्होंने क्या किया कि उसकी आँखें बंद की और उसको जो है पैसे दे दिए अब उसने जो है मतलब बहुत शुक्रिया अदा किया और फ़कीर ने जो है दुआएँ दी वहाँ से चला गया अब जाते हुए फ़कीर ने उससे कहा कि अब ये पैसे तुम मुझे ऐसे लौटाओगे कि जब भी तुम्हारे पास कोई मदद के लिए आएगा तो तुम जो है उसकी मदद करोगे वक्त बीतता रहा वो बच्चा जो था वो ग़ुलाम वो फिर किसी और के पास गया वहाँ ट्रेनिंग ली मतलब वो बिकता रहा लोग खरीदते रहे और आखिर में जब वो थोड़ा जवान हुआ तो मतलब उसकी बोलियाँ बहुत ज़्यादा लगने लगी बहुत ज़्यादा तो जिसके अंडर में वो था वो उसको लेकर जो है उसका मास्टर जो है वो उसको गजनी लेकर आया और वहाँ जो है मतलब उसके सारे गुलाम बिक गए, बस वो लड़का रह गया। अब उसके खूबसूरती के चर्चे, उसकी तलवारबाजी के चर्चे, उसकी हुनरमंदी के चर्चे जो हैं वो गौर के दरबार में पहुँचे। तो सुल्तान गौरी जो थे उस टाइम पे जो है वो हुकूमत कर रहे थे, तो उन्होंने कहा भैया वो लड़का जो है उसको बुलाओ, उसको हम भी देखें। तो ये साहब जो थे सौदागर गुलामों के, वो उसको लेकर गए वहाँ पर। उसका भैया ये लड़का हमें पसंद है, इसे हम खरीदेंगे। उसने कहा सुल्तान आली इसके जो हम इतने टके मांगते हैं, अब जो भी उस टाइम पर टका रहा हो। तो पहली बात तो ये कि सुल्तान को बहुत ज़्यादा बुरा लगा, उनको लग रहा था कि ये सौदागर जो है ये कहेगा कि ये आप मेरी तरफ से जो है आप रख लीजिए और मैं इसको कुछ पैसे दे दूँगा। तो उसको और ज़्यादा बुरा लगा कि सुल्तान के सामने आकर इसने जो है इतनी बड़ी बोली जो है वो लगाई। अब सुल्तान ने जो है अपने ईगो में आकर जो है उसको मना कर दिया। अब जो है वो उस लड़के को लेकर गया, पूरे गौर में घूमता रहा यहाँ वहाँ। अब हर किसी को वो पसंद आए, समझ रहे, हर किसी को वो पसंद आए, पर किसी को ख़रीदने की हिम्मत नहीं थी। अब वो ख़रीदने की हिम्मत क्यों नहीं हुई? क्योंकि सुल्तान आली की उस पर नज़र थी। मतलब ये कि अगर मैं उसे ख़रीदूँगा तो सीधा सीधा जो है गौर के सुल्तान से दुश्मनी ले लूँगा। अब जो है जो सुल्तान थे वो भी उससे लाइक वो भी अपना दिल दे बैठे उस पर गुलाम से, बहुत ज़्यादा बेहद मोहब्बत करते थे। अब वो धीरे धीरे जो है वो एकदम डिप्रेशन में चले गए कि इतना खूबसूरत गुलाम जो है वो हाथों से निकल गया। अब उनका एक कमांडर था जिसका नाम था कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक, नाम सुना होगा। तो कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक जो है जब उनके पास आया तो उसने देखा भैया सुल्तान आली जो है थोड़ा परेशान है, तो उससे परेशानी का सबब पूछा। जब उनको ये पता चला कि भैया एक गुलाम की वजह से जो है वो इतना परेशान है, तो उन्होंने एक तरकीब सोची। अब ये वो ज़माना चल रहा था, ये थोड़ा टाइम बीता, कि गौर के सुल्तान मोहम्मद गौरी ने जो है वो दिल्ली को फतह कर लिया था। यहाँ पर जो है दिल्ली की सल्तनत जो है वो शुरू हो गई थी। अब कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक दिल्ली आया, उसने उस सौदागर को दिल्ली बुलाया और यहाँ आने के बाद जो है जितनी कीमत उसने वहाँ मांगी थी वो उसको अदा की और उसके वो गुलाम खरीदे। अगर सुल्तान डायरेक्ट उसे ख़रीदता तो इसका मतलब ये कि वो सौदागर के सामने झुक गया। यहाँ से ख़रीदने के बाद जो है कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक उसको लेकर गया गौर, उसको सुल्तान आली को जो है उसने तोहफे में जो है वो नज़र किया और बाद में वही गुलाम जो है सुल्तान अल्तमश के नाम से जाना गया। शुरुआत में पहले वो बदायूं का गवर्नर हुआ और बाद में कुतुबुद्दीन ऐबक ने अपनी बेटी कुतुब बेगम की शादी उससे कराई, जिससे उनकी दो बेटियां हुईं, एक शहजादी रजिया और एक शहजादी शाजिया। तो दिस इज हाउ दैट सुल्तान।
And if you read more about, like, we'll stop the Iltutmish story here, but I would encourage you to go and read about him. There are smaller anecdotes about how Qutubuddin Bakhtiar Kaki also, like, considered him as one of the nice persons around. And there are different stories. If you want, I can send you pointers. Let's go outside and have a look at the other constructions that Iltutmish did or ordered. There is a pond nearby which holds very significant religious and spiritual significance, which is the Haud-e-Shamsi. He started the work on that Haud-e-Shamsi, and people who live near Vasant Kunj, if you've seen, there is a small fortress inside called Sultan Gadi. So that is actually a tomb of one of the eldest, I guess, and most, like, trusted sons of Iltutmish, who died, like, before becoming a ruler, and his tomb is there in Sultan Gadi. That bit is the original Quwwat-ul-Islam Mosque, the one inside the boundary. And as we saw on the map, Iltutmish ordered, like, extensions on that. So, in line with those screens inside, further beyond this monument, the screens there are Alauddin Khalji's screens. Okay, so those are wider and stronger, but they fell down because of their own weight, I guess. So Amir Khusro has written about those screens, about the calligraphy on those screens, but it no longer exists, so we are going to refer to this. You can imagine a more intricate version of this calligraphy itself on those screens. So Amir Khusro in Tariqi Alai writes that the calligraphy is so beautiful, like, as if it is done on wax. Because this is on stone, so metaphorically he says that it is so intricate, as if done on wax. People have like carved it with such accuracy. And these are again Quranic verses. He also praises the screens, those screens which were higher. And he writes that it seems as if the Quran is descending from heaven. It is coming from so high. Like, it seems as if it is coming to us from heaven. And also, the work is done like till such ground level that it also seems that it is going from here to the skies. So these are like some metaphors that we come across in Tariqi Alai. And for people who have been following calligraphy, in the Islamic belief, they don't like... like the architecture earlier, previous to the Sultanate era, was like what you see on the temples. You see animal figures and you see human figures. So as per the Islamic belief, like, it is not allowed to make animal or human figures, because it's a way of respecting the Almighty, that only Almighty can create this creation. But the artistic expression, it has to come out in some way. So it comes out in the form of foliage. You see a lot of calligraphy, and in the background you see flowers and stems and tender leaves decorating the structure. So that is called arabesque. On the screens inside the mosque also, like, these are writings, but intertwined with like structures. Things that are going like this, these are like representative of the foliage. So this background is known as arabesque. And you write in various calligraphic, you can call it fonts, but not exactly fonts, but in various fonts you can write on these backgrounds. For example, there is one of the most oldest form of calligraphy and also used in official records, like right now we use Times New Roman, that is the plain vanilla official font. So similarly, that time it was known as the Kufic script. And a very peculiar identifier of that is that it has right angles. So like how here you can see that this is, maybe for example, if you write something with L, okay, so you make L and a long decorated line and the rest of the word inside that. So it is housed inside right angles. That is a Qufic script. I forgot the name of this. This is a different script, but this has, it doesn't have angles. It's a rounded. So, I love studying but in this complex we see a lot of course arabesque we see as the background for a lot of other scripts. Qufic is there on the Qutub as well, and there is also on the Minar you see Tughra, that is one of the most popular forms of calligraphy, in which it was mostly used by the royals or like prominent people. They'll write their signature or their name in such a way that it becomes a shape. For example, it would be inside a, it would look as if it's a circular design with something, but it's their name written in that. So that is known as Tughra. So we'll see good examples of that inside. Again, this whole area was supposed to be an open mosque, congregation mosque. So you can imagine like a lot of travelers, locals, everyone coming here, and these acting as the big mihrabs for people standing behind also, like even around the Ahimsa Sthal area you can see these. In fact, in those days you can see these mihrabs and pray from there. So I personally like this idea a lot, that there is a symbolic thing bringing people together, but the actual prayer is like happening within me. I am directly connected to the God, but yes, I have an aura surrounding me with everyone with a similar mindset. So now, let's go inside the mosque. It's one of the prettiest sites on this campus. And slowly, it's like, it's not a conscious effort that the rulers come in and they tell me I want something Indo-Islamic. But it is like,
by necessity, as in like you want something to be built, but the artisans here are trained in the other way. So like when they carve it, actually a fusion of the, both the art forms comes, and slowly like as time progresses, this itself emerges out to be a new art form. Let's go inside. We'll just walk through these pillars and just observe how these pillars are, and then we'll talk about these inside when we see a different type of pillars inside. Like these are like longer and like better carved, and also geometry wise, if you see, this house is Qutub Minar inside. The original structure was that the Minar was outside the mosque. Iltutmish extended it in such a way that it takes Qutub inside. And then like it ends here at his tomb. There is a family of parrots inside who welcome you always when you come here early morning. So that guy looks at us. Always you'll find that parrot here checking that ki ye bar bar aa jate. And you can also see the way construction used to happen earlier. This is called the trabeate way of constructing, where you like put pillars, then horizontal surfaces, then pillars. So no arches, no domes here. This ko abhi hum bolte hain lintel pad raha hai. This is post and lintel. The horizontal is lintel. So these are beams which hold structures above when you put a ceiling there. So these are posts. Because originally this was a plinth of 27 temples, which are usually constructed on a, in Hindi it is called chabutra. This is the plinth on a higher ground, and you have the Britishers believed that this was like for rainwater to go out. It could have been the rainwater or the offerings or whatever. Like if you wash the temple, wash the shivlings and all, the water comes out, and then there are channels for the water to drop outside. Let's go inside, and you see a lot of temple motifs right from the entry gate itself. He was able to identify that some of these pillars are from a same temple, they come from a same structure, and then the rest were assembled later on. So just before we start discussing the architecture, a brief recap of what was happening in this part of the world that time. So Mohammad of Ghor comes in at around 1192, and he wants to do an act of iconoclasm. He wants to establish his own icons. So the first thing you do is the religious symbols, change the religious symbol. You don't come in and kill everyone. You just tell your own supremacy over them. And if you have to rule a land, he didn't come in as a plunderer, just to rule and rule. He wanted to rule the land. So he came in, established his symbols. The first thing was religion. But he did not have local contacts, local raw material, no knowledge of where to find what kind of stone, how to build and all. So the first thing that they did was dismantling the temples here. It was a site of, I discussed about Yoginipura earlier, the tantric temples. If you see other tantra based temples, they are again colonnaded structures. The most famous one is the one I like, is Mitavli, which looks exactly like our parliament house. It has colonnaded structures, circular, and they were like astronomical and other esoteric studies being done over there. So it is believed to be a colonnaded Hindu temple as well as Jain temples. Jains during that time had a major say in the culture, and if you study history, a lot of drifting away, like Buddha and Mahavira, they happened at the same time when like everything goes to a peak and you start getting like corruption over there. That is where people who have like who are more aware or more awakened, you see a lot of princes and kings being Buddha's followers at that time and Mahavira's followers. All of they were not poor people, mostly people who were well fed and who were done with life, enough of this. They had a shift in mindset that time. So, and then that also got corrupted over hundreds of years, and then again the shift of Shankaracharya happens and Hinduism is being revived by means of, coincidentally Sufis also come in at that time, and by means of, you will see a lot of Mirabai and wandering saints trying, reviving all them. Not trying to revive, but a revival happened at that time. So, Jains were also a major community here. Right now also you have Ahimsa Sthal here and you have a Jain Dadabadi temple right behind this. So the new rulers come in and they plunder, dismantle these temples and assemble them back to form a mosque. And this did not look like this earlier. It was all plastered to look like, these are plain white vanilla pillars. And the carvings on this, wherever you had human figures, when we go there you will see one of the Tirthankars poses. And so the easiest way to make it like in accordance with your belief is that I don't want to make human figures. So if there are figures, they simply chipped off the face to deface them. This has been there in everywhere. Even I am mentioning again the Gwalior temples because that is fresh in my memory. Out there also there are like there is the only cave temple in North India. There's a huge massive Tirthankars carved out of hills. Out there also the faces were chipped off. And if you notice Bamiyan, the Buddha statues, they were also like defaced. Similarly, the idols here were defaced, but you can clearly see like these are, for example, this is a bell. Okay. And you see the kalash form again here on these pillars. So this was the Jain and Hindu history of it, assembled here, not essentially like these belong to the same pillar, like kisi ka base hai, kisi ka torso, kisi aur ka laga diya hai, but these were symmetrical, so they've fallen in place. We walk across there and we see newer other things also, other interesting things on the pillars. This was a mandap, as I told you. If you see that section and around that also, you have a first floor, a first story there. Some people initially believed that this could have been for higher caste people or something, but there was no caste system in Islam that time out here. There was equality. That was the one major reason Sufism became popular, because of the caste system corruption in Hinduism, whereas Sufis coming and accepting everyone. So that was one big reason it became popular. So then it was Cunningham studied and other scholars as well. They came up with this idea that very likely that this was the Janana section of the mosque for women simply. And you can imagine that there is a story, again not documented, but it is believed that when Iltutmish died and the other, like his ministers, did not accept Razia as the ruler. That time this was a very active mosque. All important things happened here. So there was a practice of, this was also the code of law. So there was a practice of Faryadis coming with their complaints and telling that. So Razia knew that she was a governor here and a well-respected one. The local people accepted her supremacy and also some of the ministers. So they told that we'll support you. So you can actually imagine that there is a story. She came and prayed in one of these chambers, I don't know which one, then wore that the veil. There was a separate dress or a gown for people who have come to share the grievances. It's called the Faryadi ka, I don't know the exact name. Jama bolte this thing. So she wore that, walked inside there, and then told her Faryad that my dad gave me the reign of this land. And the people surrounding there started chanting that we support. So in a way, that was the first democratic election. So yeah, again, these are stories. There are no documented proofs. But yes, it could have been very much like, some part of it could have been true. So let's walk that side and we'll see some more interesting bits there. As per Cunningham, 19 of which could be assembled by Aibak, and so these are here. After that, they made fresh pillars. So these are the ones which are without the carvings. And you will see Mason's marks on these. जिसने बनाया था वो copyright लगा दिया उसने या signature किया हुआ है. तो जैसे यहाँ पे you see. So what they've done is they've written numerals and also Devanagari alphabet. This is probably 7 and उसके corresponding sa लिखा हुआ है सात के लिए. You similarly see वहाँ पे भी है. This is one of the Mason's marks. Numeral 3 and 3 ka T karke se likha hua hai. So these are marks from that time that who made it. And again an idol here. So a lot of these have, these bigger places have some signatures. कहीं कहीं पे नाम भी लिखा हुआ है लोगों का. And there is a date also which dates back to Vikram Samvat, which was the era of commerce here. There's one pillar which has the, see that pillar, the last one, it has a meditative figure on it. So that is one of the Tirthankars, Jain Tirthankars. Again, this is very simple trabeate. The post and the lintel, and then post and a lintel. This way it has been constructed. The arches were not there. The artisans here were not trained in making arches. That technology came from the Turks and from that side. If you've seen the Mehruli archaeological park, the tomb over there, Balban's tomb, is believed to be the first structure. Balban was towards the end of the Mamluk, the slave dynasty. His tomb has an arch, a proper arch over there. That is the oldest structure that has an arch. So these all screens also have been made by the post and lintel method only, but it has been chiseled in a way, in a round shape. Looks like an arch. It's not. It's a false arch. It's not a true arch. That was like around 1060 when Anand Pal Tomar established a capital in this area called Lal Kot. Before that, like, there have been instances of jo Suraj Kund mera lagta hai wahan pe Suraj Kund naam ka kund banaya hua tha pehle se. I guess that was the capital. I don't know what was the previous capital, but they established the main center here, Lal Kot, the walls of which still exist inside Sanjaywan. And they are famous because they were so broad that you could like have an array of horses going on the wall. It was so wide. And if you look on the Google Maps, like, you actually see, abhi aap pass mein jayenge to dikhta hai ki pahad hai with a lot of vegetation on that. But on the map you see a whole contour of the whole fort. So it's actually a fort wall which is looking like a hill now. So they established in 1060 the Lal Kot capital and ruled for a very long time, around like 1180 or so, like from the Tomars, from Anand Pal Tomar II, I guess, Prithviraj Chauhan inherited the throne. His capital was not here, but he was the ruler in this part. And Mohammed Ghori attacked like several times and could not, like, I guess 3 times, he could not succeed, but finally in 1192 he succeeded in defeating Chauhan. So that was the story so far. We'll rewind it a bit and come to this story of this pillar, iron pillar. The pillar
as per the inscription, the script is Brahmi on that, but the language is Sanskrit. So it is written that this is dedicated to Chandragupta Vikramaditya II, I guess. It's not the one who established the Mauryan Empire. It was a different Chandragupta. And it was one of the pillars in front of a Vishnu temple in Udaygiri, which is near Bhopal. And still, the top of the pillar has a hole on which like a motif was placed. So usually Garud is placed on these pillars. So the decorated part aapko dikh raha hai, that is a kind of seat for the Garud to sit on. And can you imagine the weight of this pillar? How much it is? It's a world famous metallurgical curiosity, by the way. Because it doesn't rust after so many years. The weight is 6,500 kgs, which is like huge. And on the bottom you will see some part is irregular, it's not as plain as the rest, because that is supposed to have been under the ground. So it is like 20 meters above and 3 meters below the ground it was. 23.8 meters, I guess. So it was so that one of the Tomar kings, this is the more known history, there is another version of it. So both of these versions are related to one place in Delhi, in this area. So the known, more known history is that one of the Tomar kings brought this from the Vishnu temple in Udaygiri and wanted this to be established here where it is right now. So you can imagine that from the other stories that these were temples, yogini temples or Jain temples. So, and this still exists on a raised ground. So this could have been the center pillar, or if they wanted some astronomical studies or whatever. We don't know right now, but this was here established that time. So he asked one of the scholars for the auspicious place where to put this pillar. And the scholar told that, okay, you put it here and dig it so deep that it goes, that it touches Vasuki's head. Vasuki is the snake god. There is supposed to be another level of existence beneath the ground, which is the world of snakes. There was a recent video by Sadhguru also, which tells the importance of snakes in spirituality and esoteric practices. So they are like more, they're higher consciousness as compared to us, and they can sense more, and they can even sense in US, if that, this is as per, I'm quoting Sadhguru, if there is miles away, if there is a tsunami or an earthquake going to come, they can sense it few days prior to that, at least a week prior to that. So hence the religious significance of snakes. The concept, people forgot what the science behind it is, but they just started worshipping snakes by that time. So yeah, it was believed that he told that, okay, you dig it so deep that it pierces through one of the snakes. It could have been a metaphorical way of saying that, okay, the snakes exist so many meters below, you have to dig it that low. In that time, the important messages were more poetic in nature, if you see. They're spoken verses and are also in the form of riddles or a poem. So he must have told ki itna deep jana chahiye ki saap tak pahunch jaye. So, and he told, the scholar told, okay, he took the work of like getting it installed, and he told that, okay, now it has reached that level, now your empire is sturdy, it's going to be very sturdy like this. So, and he left. The king was little like, maybe a little more modern for his times. He did not believe that ki aisa zaruri nahi ki, how do I know ki snake tak pahunch gaya hai, ya snake tak pahunch bhi gaya to ye mera empire stable rahega. So he was curious, he dug it out. He ordered ki zara dekhte hain niche kya hai. So it is said that, okay, he found traces of blood on the bottom, and then he got scared that, okay, he was telling like the truth, that it has gone to a snake, and now like if that was true, then like I have done the reverse of it, so now my empire is going for a toss. So he called him back and apologized and told ki, please put it back. So, but now this was not possible in that area, and that scholar was also like furious at him that you doubt me and now you're scared, so now you're calling me back. But this was the very auspicious place where he wanted to put, so they did not try putting it elsewhere. He said that I have installed it again, but now due to that digging and all that, the land is not as strong now, and so is your empire. It is, he referred to it as a keel. Keel means nail. So he says that ye keel ab dhili hai, and so is your empire also. And the locals in the folklore, they wrote it as keeli to dhili bhai tomar bhai matheen. So they lost their wisdom and all the tomars, and the downfall started. And it is also said that because of that word dhili, the word dhilika came up for this town, and that further leads to Delhi. This is one of the stories behind that names, that Delhi is actually Delhi. And as per land records and other records also, people whose surnames are Dhillo and some other surnames, they are actual Delhiites. Like they have, the history traces back to that time. So this is one version, the more popular version. Another version says that Iltutmish brought this from Udaygir, and after the mosque was established, he put the pinion here. Before that, he put it on the banks of Yamuna. There is another place like near the Nizamuddin Dargah. A lot of Sufi saints are there. Their graves are there. And he installed it temporarily at that place, or maybe the preparation was going on here. So temporarily it was placed there. So the folklore says that kuch din keel wahan khadi thi. So that area was named as Kilokri, Keel Khadi. So that Kilokri area, just before D&D, behind that Gurudwara that we have, that again is a historical Gurudwara, by the way. So behind that area, Yamuna used to flow that time. You still have a lot of greenery there. So that area got its name from this incident. That's the belief. What we have here right now is this iron pillar, which has not rusted without any like modern treatment. It has not rusted, and you have inscriptions over there which tell about the King Chandra, and the meaning of those inscriptions have been put up in marble stones there. So you can like have a read at that. It's also available online. So let's have a look. Like we can go there and look at the pillar from nearby and the screens, and then we'll go to Qutub.
Depression.
Yeah. इसपे cannonball attack हुआ था. I guess during the British or I don't know what time. So that those marks are still there. This cannonball. Then you can imagine that is the tomb that we went to. Those extensions happened by Iltutmish. There is one area behind this. We won't go there right now, because there's not much left. That is actually a madrasa that was set up by Alauddin Khalji. And Alauddin Khalji's tomb is also there. But there's not much left. It's only this rubble that you can see from here. I'll suggest that we first go to the other structures, and if time permits, we can take a stroll there. But there's not much actually inside. Let's go to the Qutub Minar.
So this is like, this needs no introduction, I guess, because
Amitabh Bachchan of monuments here. But I'll tell you some interesting facts. As I discussed, like now when you go to the foot and look up, because of these grooves, it looks very interesting. This is called fluting. So the angular one is angular fluting and circular is circular fluting. And I was talking about squinch arches inside Iltutmish tomb.
Yeah.
So this is a very special kind of squinch arch in which inside each arch many small arches have been built. So you'll see in Turkey and all the entrances to even the Safdarjung tomb, the entrance has a beautiful peacock figure. So those are like small squinches which like give a honeycomb kind of structure. So these are like another use of squinch arch. And if you look at the balcony railing, that has a British design. That came up later, right? It was set up by the British. It was not originally in the design. Qutubuddin Aibak, when he started the work on the mosque, he also started this work on the Minar. It is like around 14 point something meters on the bottom. Till the time like he was there from 1192 to 1211 or so, the first story got completed during the reign of Aibak. Then there was a gap. Iltutmish took over the throne and he was stabilizing the political condition. And then the work started again. And he added the second, third and fourth story. So the original design was up till the fourth story only. If you look at the fluting wise, like the second one is all round.
Yeah.
Third one is all angular.
Yeah.
And the fourth one is plain. So we don't know how it was in the time of Iltutmish, because during the time of Muhammad bin Tughluq, there was lightning that struck this tower that got like chipped off, the top story. So Firoz Shah Tughluq built it again and then added another story above it. So these two stories are in marble, the rest is sandstone. So by that time, like they had access to artisans and also the raw material, they could put marble there. Then, as I told, during Sikandar Lodi's time, there was again a lightning. But he simply repaired it. He didn't do any additions. Then during the British time, when they were conserving it, there was an earthquake. During which the top story fell off. So Smith, Major Smith, I guess, I don't know the designation of what. He was Smith who repaired it and then put another structure above it. That was a Bengali style chhatri. How you see in Bengal the constructions that time, Havelis ke upar you will see some canopies coming out. But it was like out of like the pattern. It was not like, it was standing out. It was not, to the experts that time, they said that Britishers themselves did not like that design, so it had to be removed. So it is lying inside in the lawns. We'll go there also and imagine as if we are standing at the top of it. But that gives us a good idea of how big the top is. Very small. It's like 2.7 meters, I guess. And inside the Qutub, like these are Quranic verses outside. These patterns, the calligraphy, you'll see. Just see the second band, okay, the thinner one. That is foliage. Or that is arabesque. Is the calligraphy expert here? So if you have any questions, you can just bombard him with this. Inside the Qutub, there are interesting things. There are masons' marks who write about like who made this, and also as in the actual artisan who worked, their signatures, and the king who sponsored the construction, their signatures are also there. This was built by this king, and then there also are graffitis of that time, which includes one like it is a censored abuse that somebody has written grudge about the maybe the contractor or the rulers dishonoring somebody's mother. And may your mother be so and so ravished by a donkey. Aisa karke likha hua hai. So it is documented there. Which is like not many people refer to it. But it is believed that it was one of the laborers who had some grudge against the constructor. Maybe he did not pay him well or whatever. But graffiti, similar graffiti is also mentioned inside. And what I told you about the the concept of Varah Mihir long back, like people believing that this was actually a Meru Stam. Meru means backbone, the pivotal axis. And the word Qutub also means pivotal axis, the main pillar. Okay, Qutub is also used as a metaphor for human beings. For example, Qutub Sahib was a pillar of Sufism here. So that's why the name Qutub came up. So that confusion happens, like it gets like reinforced because one of the stories inside has the mention of Prithviraj Chauhan. And it is written in as if like the word for king is Nripah in Sanskrit. So inside it is written Nirapah. Nirapah Prithvi. ऐसा inscribed है तो उसको लेकर के भी लोग they tell कि see this tells that this has been there before Gauri as well. So those confusions are there, but not as per the ASI documented things, because again like it's similar to democracy, you know. If you get 40 votes and other people get 30, you get elected, whereas 60 people don't want you on the seat. So that's why whatever evidence is more prominent, that gets documented. And I also personally think that there's no point like looking back to find the exact place. We should see like what is there today and what lesson we get from it today. So that is the thing. And these are small slit windows for light to go in. When I came here last week for a recce, there was a guy peeping out from that window. And there was a small people sapling jutting out from these calligraphy panels. So he was actually trying to pluck that out, because if it grows, the tile will break and it will come out. So I have that recorded in video, I'll try to share.
Actually, I was wondering to ask that only. Ever since they don't allow general public to go in, but do they allow historians, archaeologists to go in and still, you know,
yeah,
study
for,
the
water? For the book, Where Stones Speak, Rana ma'am actually went inside with permission. And I guess photography and all is not allowed.
Even not without plants.
Yeah. And read the inscriptions and make a note. And okay. And he himself, like, he's the one who told that these are not in order. And these have been like the order has been ruined in some of the panels. So let's go that side. We can take photos and all from that, because sun wahan pe piche se nahi aayega. You'll get a better view. And then we'll go to Alai Darwaza. Remember the map that I showed earlier? This was one of the entrances that Alauddin Khalji's extended empire had. Not empire, but this mosque area. And this particularly has been very much appreciated by the British conservationists. They were not too fond of architecture here locally in other buildings. But this building in particular, they mentioned that it is very symmetrical, and the calligraphy work here is very beautiful, and it is also believed to have the first true art. You don't see columns and posts and lintels over here. They have achieved the horizontal strength by adding arches to it. The first structure with an arch is Balgam stone, but it is all broken, there is no dome there. This is the first structure with the dome, with a true art. So later on, like, people must have started referring to it as Qutub or Minar, so it became Alai Darwaza. But back then it was just one normal gateway, of one of the six gateways in this place. Let's go to that place. That's another significance. Then we go to the lawn, allowing Khalji's ambitions and egos be satisfied. 200 years after that, like when we have Lodis here, this became the regular Jama Masjid. This was not, it was like during all these years people used to come here and worship. One of the primary priests during the reign of Sikandar Lodi, I guess, Sikandar Lodi is the person who is buried in the Lodi Gardens, the main tomb inside the Sikandar Lodi tomb. So one of the major priests, much respected priest, was Imam Zamin. So this is his tomb, Imam Zamin's tomb. If you've seen there is a small tomb called Yusuf Kattal's tomb in Chirag Delhi. Or if you've seen the Nasiruddin Chirag Delhi Dargah, that tomb is very similar to this structure. So this is the style of architecture that time. Other than this, like we know architecture wise there is no particular thing about it other than that it belongs to like Imam Zamin. Inside I was told one point, I'll just like tell you, let's go inside. That side you have Adam Khan's tomb and his cousin Kuli Khan on this side. Back then, like in older times, this used to be one big estate, no divisions between, and the Britishers had divided like the place for themselves. Adam Khan tomb, I guess, had a post office or police station in that. And Metcalf, one of the British residents, he started staying in Kuli Khan's tomb. So I'm just trying to tell you that like, this is the view that you get. Like, when you climb up the tomb, then you see Qutub Minar very nearby. So it's from this side that you see. Okay, so this is the cupola or the structure that Smith had put on the top of Qutub Minar. So this gives you a good idea of how big the top is. It's like 2.723 meters, I guess. So if you stand on the top of the Qutub Minar, you will be like in this kind of area. Right now, I guess they have some mobile towers over there and solar panels.
By the way, I'm up there.
The later British officials did not like the design. It's a beautiful structure in its own, but it didn't go well with the prevalent like, the structure existing over there. And also, it was not like the balconies, if you see from here, the fence around the balcony is Gothic in style. It's not like going with the original design. Those who have zoom lenses can just zoom in and see. So this was also one fact that was not appreciated by the later British officials. But they did not remove the balcony, okay, but they removed the cupola and placed it here. It's now known as Smith's Folly. Folly, there is a pun on the word folly here. Folly is also like structures that are made to look old in British gardens. And folly is also the act. Like, it's like a less thought after act that he did. We'll walk up to that, the last prominent structure here that we're going to discuss today. That's a sundial. It's a very small jantar mantar, it's a saurya ghadi. Sanderson's sundial. Gordon Sanderson was one of the key players who worked for ASI in conservation of the tomb of Iltutmish and other parts, other monuments in this complex. Later he joined the armed forces as well and he died fighting in France sometime in 1900 something. So this sundial was dedicated to him, and if you read, like, it has a philosophical message, like Lux Permanenta, I think it's Spanish, or I don't know what the language is. And that is Umbra, and there was one word that, so Lux means light. Light is permanent, or you can say light is eternal. Umbra is shadow. If you remember from like your solar eclipse diagrams back in school, and Umbra, Penumbra, so that is the shadow passes away, light is permanent. So that was the message written, the philosophical message for him. So then now let's go in some shade. So that's where we end our storytelling. If you have any questions, or you can ask, or if you want any links further, I can send it to you on mail.